Failure. It's a scary monster that must be avoided at all costs. It's a curse that will drag you down into the pits of hell. It's a thing that will... Whoa, stop. It's really not. After reading the novel Stoner by John Williams, it got me thinking about if failure was really such a bad thing. Some more research led me to the conclusion that no, failure is not bad. In fact, it is absolutely necessary. Why, you ask? Well, aside from the old cliche, failure is the mother of success, failure might also be the only thing that can tame the ego and save one from self-destruction. So firstly, let's not mince words. Stoner's life is full of failures. His marriage, his relationship with his daughter, and his affair, none of them end in the way he wants them to. These failures are both personal and societal, and it reaches the point where you could argue that his entire life is a failure. But do these failures ever truly break Stoner's will and resolve? No, and that's because failure brings improvement. It brings adaptation, evolution if you will. If you don't fail, how do you expect to truly learn? How do you grow? Edith manipulated him to make his life harder. Lomax manipulated him to make his work harder. Catherine is forced to move away and thus ends one of the happiest periods in Stoner's life. But these setbacks have provided Stoner with resilience, and we continue to see him power on. Stoner continues to develop his passion for literature. We even see him defy Lomax and give it to him. I would argue that Stoner's life is only a triumph because of his failures, and how he was able to accept them and even embrace them. But surely you can still triumph without failure, you say? Well, yes but no. Let me explain with a few examples. The Hollywood film industry is one of the biggest industries in the world. It churns out hundreds of movies and earns over $40 billion from the box office every year. Recently, Hollywood decided they could make millions just by remaking old movies. The new Beauty and the Beast was great. It had big budget, big names, and made big cash. The Aladdin reboot got mixed reviews from critics, but all the hype surrounding it and casting Will Smith as Genie meant that it still grossed over $1 billion worldwide. It was the same deal with the new Lion King. It had great visuals, and fans were so excited about it starring Beyoncé and Donald Glover, but critics only gave it 52%. It was enough, but lacked the energy and heart of the original. But Hollywood didn't care. As far as they were concerned, The Lion King made $1.6 billion at the box office. It's a success to them. At this point, the hubris of Hollywood is astronomical. They've let this almost unconditional success get to their head. "We found the perfect formula to make bank," they say. Cast celebs, invest lots, and watch that cash roll in. And so they decide to be daring. Let's remake a musical. What? The visuals are poo-poo? Whatever, the critics don't matter. The audience will love Taylor Swift, Jason Derulo, and James Corden. We'll make tons. And so it went ahead, and Universal Pictures comes out with this monstrosity. A lack of failure meant that Hollywood was standing on a tall tower built on weak successes. A lack of failure meant that Hollywood felt invincible and its ego became all-consuming. And a lack of failure is what caused the ultimate defeat and humiliation of Universal Pictures. A more sinister example is that of John Wayne Gacy, a professional clown, an American serial killer who lured, raped, and strangled teenage boys in the 1970s. Active for 6 years, Gacy killed over 30 victims before he was arrested in 1978, and his case marks the dangers of unceasing success. On December 30, 1977, Robert Donnelly was abducted, raped, and tortured by Gacy before being released. Despite reporting the assault, the police did not believe Donnelly, and Gacy was able to get away with no charges laid. By now, Gacy had already killed 22 victims. This incident obviously heightened Gacy's ego, and he continued to commit more murders, albeit becoming more and more complacent. After all, he'd already gotten away with so many crimes. He was obviously just too good. Even when under police surveillance, Gacy taunted officers by breaking traffic laws, knowing that the cops couldn't arrest him on such trivial things. He even regularly invited detectives for meals, at one point saying to them, "You know, clowns can get away with murder. But soon, the police began to unravel the mystery of the missing boys, and by December 1978, Gacy's luck had run out. He fell deeper and deeper into anxiety and alcoholism, living in fear and paranoia until finally on December 20, 1978, he confessed to his murders, drunk, depressed, and knowing that his arrest was inevitable. Chicago police later found 28 bodies buried in the crawl space underneath his house, and Gacy was executed by lethal injection in 1994. Gacy's lack of failure set the foundations for his eventual breakdown and self-destruction by creating an over-consuming ego. Although extreme, it's a pattern that we've seen many times before. It was Macbeth's hubris that led to his downfall. It was Hamlet's pride that led to the collapse of Denmark. Failure is not a scary monster. It forces you to learn from your shortcomings and builds character. An early failure is not a bad thing. In fact, it might just be the only thing holding you and your ego back from the cliff of self-destruction. Icarus would have lived had his wings of wax and feathers failed closer to the ground, but they didn't. And while that was a success, Icarus paid the ultimate price by flying too close to the sun. And folks, that's why we need failure. Failure is your friend. Failure is your teacher. But most importantly, failure is holding you back from the edge.